Good morning, peeps. Welcome to another vlog. We are here at a friend's house and I am installing a brand new hot water tank, as you can see right here. Want to show you where we're installing and swapping out the old one. It's in this bad boy right here. Take a look. So the first thing that we got to notice right now is that this is a bottom fed hot water tank. And what that means is that this is the hot line coming out and the cold line going in is at the bottom right here. A lot of times when I've done hot water tanks, we've had hot and cold both at the top. Cold goes in, the two elements in this electrical version heat up the water, and then hot goes out whenever there's demand for it. One thing that I ended up buying for this situation right here, I ended up buying a Klein Tool electrical tester. The homeowner had told me that they shut the breaker for the hot water tank, but it's always safer to double check and test it before moving forward, because the last thing we want to do is introduce any sort of electrical with plumbing. Let me find an outlet real quick.
Okay.
All right. So the tester is telling us that the hot water tank doesn't have any electrical to it thus far. I'm really hoping this tester is telling me the truth, fam, or else this is gonna hurt. So peeps, let's get to work. Let's have some fun. Oh, and by the way, peeps, you know what to do, baby. Let's go do some delicious electrical and plumbing.
So peeps, electric hot water tanks are a staple plumbing fixture where it's beneficial, if not necessary, to carry a voltage tester. The other appliance that plumbers install where testers would be useful as well is a dishwasher, and I keep a voltage tester on my kit specifically for these two applications. Now the reason why I might seem nervous in this video about electricity is because I once had a faulty voltage tester where it would actually activate almost on any wire that I would touch. Thankfully, my father had a second tester on him which proved to be way more accurate, but in the back of my mind that experience has made me much more nervous around the tool because I know now that it can misread, and God forbid that it misreads that there isn't voltage when there is, you have a formula for disaster.
Okay, here she is in all her glory. Just want to show you the working parts to the hot water tank. First of all, we got ourselves our cold inlet right over here. On the other side, we have our sediment faucet. This is what you use to drain the hot water tank whenever you need to drain it. We have two access panels. This is the one that's going to be for the electrical. You have your electrical input right here. Up above, like I showed you before, this is the hot water. You have your temperature and pressure relief valve. And this little thing right here is a little bit awkward because it doesn't go in, so I don't know what's going on with that. But this is where the sacrificial anode is. You're going to see a hexagon right here. And the sacrificial anode is a rod that is installed inside a hot water tank so that corrosive materials end up sacrificing the anode, ends up going for the anode and deteriorating the anode instead of the steel casing on the inside. Because what happens is that if there was no anode, it would automatically start eating at the walls of the steel inside the hot water tank itself, which is why we have to replace our sacrificial anodes something like every 5 to 7 years. But those are the working parts. There are two elements inside this hot water tank, and those elements heat up and warm the water, and the other one keeps the water warm as well.
So as you've seen me do in the past, I'm going to tape and dope these threads on this tank, but I'm using a non-toxic pipe dope called triple thread that will not contaminate the water entering or leaving the unit. A lot of these pipe dopes have surfaced over the years and are really useful for threads on potable water systems, so keep an eye out and take a look at your suppliers.
Alright, so I thought I recorded this, but apparently I didn't. I went outside and I soldered 2 3/4 by half FIPs to 2 pieces of copper. I ended up just taking a random number, which was 1 foot, and I soldered a length of pipe on each of them. I know the one on the bottom is going to be very short, and the one on the top might be a little bit short for what we need. Usually we start off with that because we're going to have to end up putting other fittings as well, like shutoff valves and couplings, etc. So I'm going to go ahead and install them on the hot water tank, and then we're going to continue going. Let's go.
Now, by code, we only require to throw a valve on the cold side of the tank, but from experience, it's really useful to have a valve on the hot side whenever you have to repair and replace a tank for the future. I learned this from my father, and I think he was onto something, so I make sure that when I do hot water tanks, I pipe them in the exact same way. Something I gotta say is that I'm using way more type L in my piping, and cleaning it is a much bigger ordeal than using type M because it always manages to create a strong edge to it whenever you cut it. And I find that I absolutely have to file it down or I will sweat buckets trying to get it into fittings. And there is nothing more frustrating than cleaning and pasting your pipe to eventually wrestle it into a fitting because the paste gets all over your hands and now it's slippery. Now you can't grip the pipe correctly, so it's even more difficult to push it into the fitting. So do yourself a favor and file it down relentlessly and then dry fit it into a fitting to see if it goes in and then paste it.
Alrighty, I just turned the water on, so we are going to fill up the hot water tank. You don't turn on the electrical until you fill up the water tank all the way to the top, and once it's full of water, then you can turn on the elements, or they'll burn out, basically. So take a look. Moment of truth. This is all pressurized right now up to here. We're gonna open up this valve, let the cold in. Cold valve is leaking. Okay, but it's filling up. So far sounds good. It will basically fill up until it reaches this valve here. This valve is closed. Upon filling up till here, we'll be able to pressurize this valve, see if it's holding, see if the FIP is okay as well. So we're just gonna wait now. So just to describe to you what I was doing, as I was filling it up, what I didn't want to happen is the hot water tank to have a little pocket of air at the top, because what you got to imagine is there's air inside the tank and water's going to start filling it up and it's going to actually compress that air. So what I was doing is playing around with the temperature and pressure relief valve right here. And what you can do is actually activate it by turning it on. And the moment water drains out, you know that there's no more air in the tank, that it's all clear, and you have water now at least to this level. Hopefully it's all the way up here, but there might be a little bit of air in there as well. What we're going to do now is go ahead and release it like so. We are now gonna go see how the water reacts everywhere else. And this here is the breaker, friends. Water heater is the only one turned off right now. Everything else looks normal. What we're gonna do is flip this switch. Let's go check out our wire over there. Okay. It's live. Now we gotta give it some time and we gotta let it warm up. In the meantime, I'll do some cleaning and we'll come back right in a couple of seconds. Let's go. Cold water. Hot water. See that steam? And just like that, peeps, we are done a whole day of plumbing. If you haven't already, please do me a favor. Hit that subscribe button down below and that bell notification so you know exactly when we're getting videos. Smash that thumbs up, share with friends, and I'll see you plumbers very soon. Kenny Molotov, guys. Peace, baby.